Welcome back to Cradle. So things have gone very, very wrong with Ida. And apparently if I bring her to a powerful source of electricity, I can bring her to her senses for a little bit. Because as you can see, she has come apart. Yeah, and it's storming right now, raining heavily, and there's lots of lightning, so I think the powerful source of electricity is probably the lightning. At least that's what I'm guessing. God, it feels so weird to just be taking the upper half of her body. Especially since she's twitching. Ugh. But yeah, can I take her? I can't put her in my inventory, but I can pick her up. What about the parts of her that have fallen off? Can I take them? Where the hell did her chest go? There it is. I can't put it back on. I'll just put it in my inventory. Alright, hold on. Let me check outside first. Before I take her body out here. Oh my god, this music. This music is really good and really creepy. So where's the lightning hitting? I saw it hit over there. I'm assuming it's the lightning that I need to take her to. I don't actually know. I mean, any sort of, like, tall metal structure would probably do it. Oh, there we go. It just hit up there, didn't it? I need to take her to Gerbera Gardens, don't I? Let me see, is it gonna hit again? I definitely saw sparks. Yeah, it's definitely in there. Alright. Alright, come on, let's go. God, sorry. This is really, really awkward. It's like I'm carrying around a dismembered corpse with me. And I guess I sort of am. Oh god, look at the way her neck just flops around. Ew. I really wish I could put her in my inventory so I didn't have to look at her face like this. I should probably get in the thing. Yeah, you know, at this point it's faster just to keep running. The thing is, though, even if I actually hit her with electricity, and she's able to speak for a few minutes, which is what it said, you know, bring her to her senses for a few minutes, what's that actually going to do? Is that really going to help her? Will she be able to tell me something I can do to help her? She didn't seem to know what to do before she kind of exploded. How is she going to know how to do something now? I'm not really sure what the long-term plan is here. Okay, so where do I need to go? It keeps hitting really high up there. What the hell was that? Oh, Ungots! What does the message say? Secure Ida in a vertical position at the center of the ruined flower bed. Right here? Okay, and it says something about a sparking cable. Hey, Ungots! Hey! You know, I owe a... Whoa. I mean, I owe Ungots my life. Ungots carried me as a child to Botchin. I really hope I don't get shocked here? Okay, I got shocked. I was just thinking, I hope the lightning doesn't hit when I'm touching the damn thing. It did. Come on, let's be fast. Oh, jeez. Alright, hold on, I gotta wait again. Let's wait a second. Oh, god. Alright, calm down. Alright. Oh, gotta remove the lid.
Right.
There we go. This is not going to be a pleasant awakening for her. This is essentially like using paddles on somebody.
Are you there? Ida.
I'm here.
How do you feel?
Strange.
Strange? In what way? Describe your state.
I feel anxious.
That's good.
Good?
I don't know if that is good.
Yes. Just don't shut down. Look at me.
Why?
I'll explain everything later.
We're not about to do some sort of telepathic thing, are we? Okay, so that's actually the end. As soon as that started, I was like, wait, this feels like the end credits. But it felt way too soon, and I didn't see any name show up, so I was thinking, hopefully it's not. But it is! That felt like it ended way too soon. Am I supposed to know what just happened there? Because I have no idea. Okay, here's the one key thing that I saw. We saw you or somebody, whoever the camera was, you know, taking the perspective of. You saw you texting on your phone and sitting across from Ida, the actual Ida, not the robot Ida, but the original Ida. Sitting across from her. And you were texting that number. Hold on, I have it written down here. Where is it? 3513. The special number, 3513, texted to something coach, which I believe was the researcher who... Well, I remember reading the articles about how, like, there's this special number. If only we could go back in time and just, tell this researcher this number, it would have averted every bad thing from happening. Right? Just that one number. 3513. And that's what happened, but, how? I'm sorry, did I just look into her eyes and travel through time and then save everybody? Like, what? I don't... Huh? What just happened? I don't get it. I, Enibish, or whoever I am, told Ida, look at me. Right, like, there's obviously looking is a very important thing in this game in terms of transferring memories and stuff like that, so obviously he was saying that for something like that to happen, some sort of transfer or something, or maybe one of those strange psychic incidents or something, but did we just time travel? Otherwise, why did we text the number that would save the world to coach? I don't get it. I really, really don't get it. I really don't get it. Alright, let's see if something else happens here. Maybe there's a scene after the credits. Please be a scene after the credits. Please be a scene after the credits. Please be a scene after the credits. It's loading something. Okay. Is it loading the main menu? Oh, it's loading the main menu. That's it, huh? New beginning. Yeah, a new beginning. We averted everything from happening somehow. I don't get that at all. Wow, this game is really uneven. It's really, really uneven. I loved it so much at first, and I mean, I certainly don't hate it now, by any means. But I loved it so much at first, and then these annoyances started to pop in. Especially the minigames. The minigames just felt like a waste of time. And then some other things, like finding the flowers was pretty frustrating, unnecessarily frustrating. And stuff like that. Mostly the minigames, though. Were really a waste of time. So, it was a bit uneven already, but I really don't like that ending. That makes it even more uneven. I really, really don't like it. It's incredibly unsatisfying. It felt way too short. I mean, sorry, not like the game felt too short. The game was a fine length, but I mean, like, it felt like the ending came before everything was actually resolved enough. Right? Like, it was a premature ending. It just didn't feel like the right time to end. Felt way too sudden. Yeah. Dang. Well, Cradle is definitely a flawed gem. It's definitely a gem. It's beautiful. I mean, heck, let's just load up a save game. This one should be fine. Yeah, I want to stare at beautiful stuff while I talk about this game. Yeah, I mean, just look at this. It's incredibly beautiful. It's beautiful, it's got wonderful music, it's got a very fascinating world, and an incredible amount of, like, believability and care that's been taken to making the world actually believable. And the incredible care that they've put into making notes, so many notes. You know, in the vast majority of games, these, like, fairly blurry newspaper clippings and stuff all over the ground and all over the board would be stuff that's just, you know, it's just background, it's just a texture, and that's as far as it goes. But here, they actually took care to make basically every single separate thing readable. And all of it is actually stuff that's relevant to the world and, you know, makes it more believable and fleshes it out. It's really amazing. The amount of detail just in this one room here is absolutely astounding. It's really incredible how much work has been put into the world. Whoops. Might have broken that teapot. So yeah, it's pretty incredible. And again, another example, the socks. Like, just the fact that this, even the texture for the socks, the textures for the socks, shows that they're well-worn, you know, and they've been stitched up by hand. Like, everything feels lived in and feels real and incredibly detailed. So they've done a fantastic job of making a believable world. They've done a great job with that. But a lot of the gameplay, especially the mini-games, not so good of a job. Pretty tedious, unfortunately. But damn, have they created a beautiful and well-fleshed-out world. They really have. Well, that's about all I can think of to say. But you know what? I'm not going to end this episode here, because this is a very short episode. And there's still a couple things I want to do. You know what I want to do? I've always wanted to just run out to the hillside and just explore. For two main reasons. One is just to see what I could find, if I can find anything. And the other is, I'm wondering, how far can you go? Will you hit an invisible wall at some point? Or will something else happen? I don't know, but you know what? Let's go find out. It's probably going to be a pretty uneventful little, well, not a little, but long journey into the hillside. But it should be nice and relaxing, and let's see if we can find something. Yeah, so first I want to follow these little, well, not, again, not little. I want to follow these large, whatever these are, these rings. I want to follow those all the way up the hillside. And I already know that at this ring where I'm aiming at, there's a sign at the bottom of it, because I've already been there, but I want to keep going. See how far I can go, and see if there's something special out here. Probably not going to be much commentary for this for the most part, so just sit back, enjoy the sounds of nature. Bertie. Hey. A bunch of birds. They look so tiny compared to Ongots. Ongots, my savior bird. You know, maybe it's Ongots that allowed us to time travel. Time traveling savior bird? Sure. Why not? I'm seriously wondering how far I can go, because, I mean, just looking at the terrain, it doesn't look like there's some impassable, like, mountain that's too steep to actually walk on. So unless there's an invisible wall, I really don't know how they're gonna stop me. The view should be pretty nice from on top of this hill here, too. Oh my god, yeah. And what if I follow the river? There's gotta be something up here. I know it, there's gotta be something. Alright, there's another sign. Gerbera Garden 1. So I guess there's multiple gardens. Yeah, seriously, how are they gonna stop me? It looks like it goes on forever. Like contamination sort of thing, leaving or entering a bubble, I think. It's like I'm getting sicker as I keep going. I'm gonna keep going just to see what happens. Do I wake up back at the yurt? There's the feathers again. Ongots have saved me. Okay, so it just puts me a bit back. Okay, so you can't go on forever. I do wonder how large this bubble is, though. How far can I go in the other directions? Like, if I just follow the water. What about this way? Like, can I spot any structures? No, I don't see anything. I bet there's just, like, a note hanging around one of these rocks out here in a field or something. But yeah, I'm gonna go this way and I'm gonna follow the water. I wouldn't be surprised if there's something under the water, too. Yeah, I bet there's something under the water. Maybe an Easter egg or something. It'd be so easy to miss it, though. Plus, it's kind of making me nauseous to stare down like that. Ugh. Gotta be hitting the edge of the bubble soon now. I've gone pretty far. I'm really surprised I haven't hit the edge of the world yet. There's gotta be something over here, right? Doesn't seem like it, though. Sorry if the bunny hopping's annoying, but it lets me get a little bit better of a view. How have I not hit the edge of the world? How far does this go? Oh, here we go. Can I make it to the pile of rocks, where there's probably nothing? Guess what? There's nothing. I'm surprised. I'm really surprised. And a bit disappointed. I was expecting to find something. But basically all I found was one sign. that was it. Just a sign. You know, there could still be something in a different direction. There might be something under the water. But for the most part, it seems like all of the incredible detail in the environment, it looks like it's basically been saved just for the yurt, and right around the yurt, and for Gerbera Gardens. Kind of just the key things. It looks like they really focused all their work on those. Which is fine. I mean, I know this game was made by a small team, so obviously I don't expect the level of detail you found in the yurt to be everywhere. That would be pretty crazy. But I was expecting to find at least a couple things, venturing that far out. Let me just take a quick look at this patch of trees up here. Maybe there's something. No. No, I think it's just the same thing in this direction. Yeah. I guess that's it. Well, folks, unfortunately that seems to be the end of the game. The very sudden and disappointing ending, coupled with some explorations out into the far distance that I've always wondered about, which were also disappointing. Definitely not the strongest note to end on. But I still really like this game. It's definitely a flawed gem. Very flawed, very uneven. The minigames are really annoying. Multiple times I softlocked the game and had to quit out and reload a save game because of the dialogue not letting me leave it, you know? Like with the talking with Ida a couple times, plus the tablet getting me stuck. So it's kind of buggy. The minigames are really annoying. The ending is way too sudden and unsatisfying. But it's also very, very beautiful. And it's got a wonderful soundtrack and an incredibly detailed world. At least for the kind of two key locations, the amount of detail and work that's been put into the world and into the universe is really incredible. So that has been Cradle. Thank you very much for joining me, and I hope you enjoyed.